بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه أما بعد We talk about the ninth hadith that is mentioned 40 نووية today and this hadith is narrated by أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه عن أبي هريرة عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه عبد الرحمن بن صخر قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول ما نهيتكم عنه فاجتنبوه وما أمرتكم به فأتوا منه ما استطعتم فإنما أهلك الذين من قبلكم كثرة مسائلهم واختلافهم واختلافهم على أنبيائهم رواه البخاري ومسلم. This hadith is mentioned in al-Arba'in al-Nawawiyyah and also mentioned by al-Imam Bukhari and Imam Muslim. In this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, مَا نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْهُ فَاجْتَنِبُوا Whatever I have forbidden you from attaining, then you must seize at once. وَمَا أَمَرْتُكُمْ بِهِ فَأْتُوا مِنْهُ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ Whatever I've commanded you to attain, then do of it as much as you can. Now, we know that the acts of prohibitions are divided into two different categories. Of course, a nahi here is in general. So the Prophet ﷺ has a general form of prohibition in terms of doing things that are prohibited by the Quran and the Sunnah, which are clearly forbidden, or doing things in terms of prohibition for choosing that which is better. So in this hadith, the Prophet ﷺ tells us, مَا نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْهُ فَاجْتَنِبُوا Whatever I have forbidden you from attaining, then you must avoid it. And in this case, the scholars have divided this prohibition into two different parts. Nahi tahrim, meaning that this is forbidden, and if one is to act upon that which is forbidden, like committing fornication, killing, stealing, doing drugs, drinking alcohol, then there's a punishment that is prescribed for that in this dunya, and perhaps also in the hereafter. So this is called nahi tahrim, means that it's a forbidden for the purpose of prohibiting this, meaning that it's outlawed from a Sharia perspective. The other type of prohibition, which pertains to the moral character of the human being, meaning that Prophet ﷺ is prohibiting us here because it's unbefitting of a Muslim, to do something like this. For example, in the hadith of Prophet ﷺ, he says, when you are about to eat, سَمِّ اللَّهِ وَكُلْ بِيَمِينِكِ وَكُلْ مِمَّا يَلِيكِ Say Bismillah and then eat with your right hand and then eat from that which is closest to you. So if someone did not say Bismillah, we cannot say that this is prohibited, meaning that we cannot say that it's prohibited to the extent that there's a punishment in this dunya or in the hereafter that is prescribed for not saying Bismillah when you eat. But it's unbefitting of a Muslim who is grateful to the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and endeavor on a path of rendering gratitude for that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon them, not to say Bismillah when they eat. And also it is unbefitting of a Muslim to eat with their left hand, because that's considered from an Islamic perspective, bad etiquettes. And similarly, one should not reach for the dish that is furthest from them, but rather they should start with that which is closest to them on the table. مَا نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْهُ فَاجْتَنِبُوا And it is by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made prohibited because it is bad for us. It may not be 100% bad, just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْخَمْرِ وَالْمَيْسِرِ قُلْ فِيهِمَا إِثْمٌ كَثِيرٌ وَمَنَافِعُ لِلنَّاسِ وَإِثْمُهُمَا أَكْبَرُ مِنْ نَفْعِهِمَا They ask you about khamr, means that alcohol, and measurably anything that makes the mind goes away, disappears, or compromises the judgment of the human being, is also prohibited. Al-Maysir, gambling. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْخَمِرُ وَالْمَيْسِرُ قُلْ فِيهِمَا إِثْمٌ كَبِيرٌ وَمَنَافِعُ لِلنَّاسِ وَإِثْمُهُمَا أَكْبَرُ مِنْ نَفْعِهِمَا Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala beforehand is telling us that in the alcohol, drinking alcohol, or the consumption of alcohol, and in the dealing or playing gambling, with one's wealth and the bounties that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon us, there's tremendous harm in that. And in it, there's some level of benefit. However, the harm way outweighs the benefit, so therefore it is prohibited. So no one can come back and argue and say, well, there's some level of goodness in alcohol, there's some level of benefit, be it financial by producing it and selling it, or be it health because some experts, supposedly, they said that there's some level of benefit in, you know, drinking wine in moderation or any of that. But that benefit can be attained by consuming that which is tayyib, that which is purely good, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made permissible. But even if there is no substitute for that little benefit, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it prohibited because there's tremendous evil and harm that accompanies drinking alcohol and gambling. So in this case, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِثْمُهُمَا أَكْبَرُ مِن نَفْعِهِمَا. So therefore, you know, the harm that they cause is far more tremendous, far greater than the benefit that anyone can materialize by way of producing, consuming, you know, or selling, you know, alcohol, or by way of gambling and establishing the casinos and so on and so forth. So in this case, this is a prohibition that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made. The default is that everything is permissible. So what is prohibited is an exception to the rule. And it's prohibited for a reason, a tremendous wisdom that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has, you know, legislated or has made as a result of this legislation of prohibition. And this wisdom, some people may materialize part of it, some may materialize a greater part of it, some may not understand why. But at the end, we believe as Muslims that everything, as a rule of thumb, everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made prohibited, He has made it prohibited because it's bad for us, because there's tremendous harm in it for us. And everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made obligatory or preferable for us to do, He has done it so, He has legislated so because there's tremendous benefit in it, in us, for us, in this dunya and in the hereafter. مَا نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْهُ فَاجْتَنِبُوا. So we can see that whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made prohibited, we really have no need for it. We have no need for alcohol. We have no need for killing. No one can come and say, you know, I can't get through the day without killing a person. You know, I can't get through the day without drinking. I cannot get through the day without selling drugs or any of that. No one can make that statement. People, to the contrary, can live a perfectly normal and happy life without all these evil things that we mentioned, or the evil that comes from practicing or you know, dealing with these evil things. So we can see that the prohibition is an exception to the rule, which is everything is permissible except that which is harmful. So we look, for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الْيَوْمَ أُحِلَّ لَكُمُ الطَّيِّبَاتِ. Today, that which is tayyib, that which is good for you, is made permissible for you to eat, drink, and wear. So we look, for example, when it comes to food, everything is permissible except that which is bad for us, like eating pork, eating the dead animal, eating an animal that's ill or been suffocated, or any of that. So all of that is bad for us, and that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it prohibited. We look at, you know, drinks that we drink. Everything is permissible except alcohol and intoxicants, that which will, you know, basically compromise our mental and physical health. We look at clothing. Everything is permissible except, you know, minor exceptions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, has made, prohibited for men and has made permissible, you know, for women. So we can see that the exception in the prohibition, not in the that which is permissible. وَمَا أَمَرْتُكُمْ بِهِ فَأْتُوا مِنْهُ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ. So here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala conveys to us a message at the tongue of His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whatever I have commanded you to attain, then attain of it as much as you can. Notice this was not mentioned, the standard as much as you can, when it came to the prohibition, because there is no effort involved in staying away from that which is evil, that which is harmful, that which is forbidden. But here, you know, a rule of thumb, which is, this is one of the fiqh rulings that the scholars established, that taklif joins istita'a, means that whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made something obligatory upon us, He has made it obligatory with the understanding that you are able to perform it. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا. It is ordained that we perform the pilgrimage once in a lifetime, and this is a right that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, an ibadah that He has commissioned us with. And then He says at the end of the ayah, مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا, means that so long that you're able to perform the hajj physically, you have the financial means, you have the transportation, you have the accessibility to Mecca without causing yourself any harm or exposing yourself or wealth or your family, you know, to dangers. So therefore, these conditions, you know, must exist, is that you can perform the Hajj physically, financially, and without any harm caused to you and your family. So here, This is what it's meant. Similarly, the man who came to the Prophet ﷺ and he basically narrates this hadith where a person who was ill could not pray standing. So the Prophet ﷺ said, if you cannot pray standing, sit down. And if you cannot pray sitting down, then lie down. So therefore, manat al-taklif, you know, the fact that one is obligated to perform all of these obligatory acts of worship must be accompanied with the ability to perform them. And if they cannot be performed to their, you know, to the max, as prescribed in the ibadah that the Prophet ﷺ has taught us, then we perform it to the level that the Prophet ﷺ has legislated for us, you know, to bring it down from standing up in salah to sitting down to lying down. Or perhaps in the month of Ramadan, those who cannot fast, then they can feed a miskeen. You know, those who are ill temporarily, they can break their fast, or traveling, can break their fast when they witness the month of Ramadan, and then they would make up for it, you know, after that. So when it comes to acts of prohibitions, you know, there's a punishment prescribed for that, and therefore there's no effort involved, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to commission us with something that is, you know, prohibited, and we are unable, you know, to avoid it. And similarly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not commission us with an obligatory act of worship, you know, beyond our ability. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, مَا جَعَلَ عَلَيْكُمْ فِي الدِّينِ مِنْ حَرَجٍ. That He, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with His graciousness and mercy, He has not made any hardship beyond that which we can endure in legislating the ibadat that are obligatory, you know, for us to perform. وَمَا أَمَرْتُكُمْ بِهِ فَأْتُوا مِنْهُ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ. Of course, it's impossible, it's inconceivable that one person can perform all of the ibadat that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated in the Quran and the Sunnah. And here we're talking about the ibadat that are obligatory and that are like to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, the obligatory acts of worship, there is no choice for the Muslim. They must perform that to the best of their ability. And if they don't, then they are in the danger zone of exposing themselves to the wrath and the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this dunya and in the hereafter. So in the mandub, that which is like to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's so many ibadat that none of us could possibly, you know, practice these ibadat all the time. For example, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to fast every Monday and Thursday. He used to fast 3 days out of the month. He used to stand up qiyam al-layl, half of the night, one third of the night, you know, a little bit less, a little bit more. So all of these are nawafil. So it's inconceivable to come and say that every Muslim must perform all these nawafil that the Prophet ﷺ has performed, because none of us will be able to. So that's why the Prophet ﷺ said, وَمَا أَمَرْتُكُمْ بِهِ. So whatever He commanded us to do, what I've commanded you to do, be it the obligatory or the mandub, فَأْتُوا مِنْهُ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ. So the obligatory must be done, all of it. That's the minimum. The mandub must be done to some degree, or ought to be done to some degree, because this is, of course, you know, the character of the Muslim. This was befitting of one who is committed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to the deen of Islam. Now there's an issue among the scholars that I brought up speaking about this hadith. Which one is better? To stay away from acts of prohibition, or to attain all of the obligatory acts and that which is mandub? Of course, those who said it's better to stay away, it's more serving, more worshipping, more devoting, you know, it's more of a devout behavior to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to stay away from acts of prohibition. Why? Because the hadith began with that. The hadith began with, مَا نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْهُ فَاجْتَنِيبُ. Whatever I've forbidden you from, whatever I've prohibited you from attaining, then you must seize at once. Add to that, of course, in another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to what's translated, or what's roughly translated, اتَّقِ مَحَارِمُ اللَّهِ تَكُنْ أَعْبَدَ النَّاسِ. Stay away from that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made forbidden, you become the most serving to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So one group of the scholars ascribe to the opinion that staying away from acts of prohibition is most or more deserving, more befitting of a Muslim, and more serving and worshipping to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The other group, which seems to be most of the evidence leaning towards the other group, they said, no, attaining acts of worship that are obligatory is more serving to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of course, some of the evidence they present is the ayat of the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks to those who did not pray in this dunya. مَا سَلَكَكُمْ فِي سَقَرْ. What have landed you in Saqar? وَعِيَادَ بِاللَّهِ. It's a place that is very deep in the hellfire. What have landed you there? قَالُوا لَمْ نَكُمْ مِنَ الْمُصَلِّينَ. They said, we were not among those who prayed. Similarly, and when it comes to zakah, in the hadith, what is roughly translated, the Prophet ﷺ says that whoever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows upon them much wealth in terms of jewelry, be it gold, silver, you know, real estate, whatever the case might be, and they do not pay the zakat on it, إِلَّا سَأَلَ اللَّهَ الرَّجْعَ. Except that when the time comes for the soul to part ways with the body, he would say, رَبِّ ارْجِعُونَ. حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءَ أَحْدَهُمُ الْمَوْتُ قَالَ رَبِّ ارْجِعُونَ لَعَلِّي أَعْمَلُ صَالِحًا فِي مَا تَرَكْتُ كَلَّا إِنَّهَا كَلِمَةٌ هُوَ قَائِلُهَا وَمِنْ وَرَائِهِمْ بَرْزَخٌ إِلَى يَوْمِ يُبْعَثُونَ. That when one is presented with death, when the angel of death comes to a person, and this person sees their place and what awaits them, وَالْعِيَادَ بِاللَّهِ, in the hellfire because they did not pay their zakat. Of course, in the collective sense of the word, that applies to the disbelievers and to the mushriks. But also to some degree, it applies to some corrupted Muslims. Those who are engaged in, you know, not attaining the obligatory acts of worship, or attaining and practicing that which is forbidden. But here, when it comes to not paying one's zakat, the Prophet ﷺ says, this ayah also applies to the one who did not pay zakat. He would say, oh Allah, take me back. لَعَلِّي أَعْمَلُ صَالِحًا فِي مَا تَرَكْتُ. Perhaps I will do better with that which I have left behind. And then of course the answer comes, كَلَّا, indeed you shall not be able to. إِنَّهَا كَلِمَةٌ هُوَ قَائِلُهَا, it's a word that they shall utter at the time of death. وَمِنْ وَرَائِهِمْ بَرْزَخٌ إِلَى يَوْمِ يُبْعَثُونَ. And of course there's a barrier between them and, you know, and coming back to this dunya. And even if this barrier was not there, they will not be able to, because thus Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded. So this is some evidence that the scholars say that attaining the obligatory acts of worship is more serving and more of a devout practice towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Add to that, of course, they mention the story of, you know, Iblis, ta'anahullah, Satan, and the story of Adam, alayhi salam, is that Iblis was commanded to perform sujood. So that's an obligatory act, and he refused. And as a result, he was doomed to the hellfire for eternity. And he was cursed, and he was expelled from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. On the other side, Adam alayhi salam was commanded to stay away, means that that's an act of prohibition, to stay away from Eden, you know, from a particular tree or a particular, you know, type of trees in paradise. That's not, you know, the point. But the point is, he was commanded, he was given an act of prohibition, stay away from that. And then he violated that act, he violated that command, and he ate from the tree. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted his tawbah, his repentance. So therefore, an act of prohibition that was forgiven, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has accepted the tawbah of Adam, and as a result, you know, Adam is among those who have obtained salvation. But of course, there's another element to add to this, you know, parable, or this comparison, if you will, is the fact that Satan insisted upon, even when it was brought to his attention, you know, and he was asked, قَالَ وَمَنَعَكَ أَلَّا تَسْجُدَ إِذْ أَمَرْتُكَ, what have prevented you from making sujood now that I've commanded you? So he was reminded, قَالَ أَنَا خَيْرٌ مِنْ. He became, you know, more arrogant, and he came up with an excuse why he would not even do it in spite of the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered him. But in the case of Adam alayhi salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ عَهِدْنَا إِلَىٰ آدَمَ مِنْ قَبْلِ فَنَسِي وَلَمْ نَجِدْ لَهُ عَزْمًا. And we have taken a covenant from Adam alayhi salam before, and he has forgotten. And this is really the word insan, a human being in the Arabic language, according to the linguists, come from the word nasi. And that's why we are called insan. So therefore, we are bound to forget. And sometimes we forget to pray. You know, something happens, we get busy and we forget. Sometimes we forget that we're fasting and we may eat during the month of Ramadan. So we forget. And this is what happened with Adam. So he did not defy the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala out of arrogance, but rather out of forgetfulness. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he immediately repented when he remembered. And that's a very important difference between the two. So going back to obligatory acts of worship versus prohibitions, which one is more serving to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, the scholars lean towards more attaining the obligatory acts of worshiping to be more serving to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But also attaining these obligatory acts of worship requires that we stay away from that which is prohibited. Because the Prophet ﷺ says in the hadith, that whoever his salah does not prevent him or protect him from attaining al-fahsha wal-munkar, the greater form of evil and sin, and that which is prohibited by the sharia, فَلَا خَيْرَ فِي صَلَاتِ, there's no good in their salah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ, salah forbids you and prohibits you from you know, attaining the fahsha and the munkar. You are praying 5 times a day. So you're always vigilant and remembering of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how can you, you know, after the salah, perform a greater sin or a big sin or any of that? It's very difficult to do that. It's almost inconceivable for a Muslim to do that who prays faithfully 5 times a day, attaining, you know, achieving in their salah, the pillars of salah, and the wajibat, that which is obligatory, and the sunnah, that which is anafila. That is just very inconceivable. Moving on to the rest of the hadith, مَا نَهِيْتُكُمْ عَنْهُ فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ وَمَا أَمَرْتُكُمْ بِهِ فَأْتُوا مِنْهُ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ فَإِنَّمَا أَهْلَكَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ كَثْرَةُ مَسَائِلِهِمْ وَاخْتِلَافُهُمْ عَلَى أَنْبِيَائِهِمْ. What have destroyed prior believing nations before you? And this is a disclaimer and a warning that the Prophet ﷺ has given us, that what has caused, you know, the failure and the doom of prior nations, كَثْرَةُ مَسَائِلِهِمْ, the frequent questioning. And we've been prohibited from asking so many questions. And at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, the Sahaba, they did not ask very many questions. They would wait and they would be very happy and overjoyed to actually see someone coming from a distance to ask the Prophet ﷺ a few questions so they could sit and listen and learn. So this questioning does not apply to understanding the Quran and the Hadith. So when we inquire and, you know, and question and ask about the interpretation of ayat and the interpretation of the Sharia ruling and the interpretation of the Hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, that is favorable. That's not the questioning, you know, that the Prophet ﷺ tells us about or warns us against. That type of question is what a man said when the Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ فَرَضَ عَلَيْكُمُ الْحَجِّ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made hajj obligatory upon you. So a man, before even performing his first hajj, what does he say? أَفِي كُلِّ عَامٍ يَا رَسُولُ. Every year, O Prophet of Allah. So the Prophet ﷺ, you know, did not reply. So the man repeated that, you know, second or third time. So the Prophet ﷺ, he could see that he was not, you know, pleased with this man's questioning. He said, لو قلت نعم, had I said yes, it would have become obligatory upon you to perform Hajj every single year. And you have not been able to. You know, then leave me with that I've commanded to do. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُ. There is no point in this question. You have not performed your first Hajj, and you're asking about that. فِي كُلِّ عَامٍ. Is it going to be every year? Well, do the first year, then we'll talk. Inshallah. فِي كُلِّ عَامٍ يَا رَسُولُ. So here the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, إِنَّمَا أَهْلَكَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ. And by the way, there's something called, you know, in our Sharia, الفقه الافتراضي. فقه الافتراضي means, what if this happens, what we do? In other words, if we ever to make it to live on Mars, or to live on the moon itself, how do we cite the Hilal? So the scholar said this is الفقه الافتراضي, and this is the type of questions that really yields no benefit. In other words, it's not going to add to your righteousness, it's not going to add to your taqwa, it's not going to add to your pile of deeds, you know, that you're going to perform. It's like, when we live on the moon, we'll look into the issue, if we ever need to live on the moon, or on Mars, or any other planet. So here, يعني الفقه الافتراضي, suppose this happened, or suppose that happened, many of the scholars responded by saying, well, did it happen yet? So the person would say, no, not yet. They said, when it happens, let us know, we'll look into it, inshallah. Okay, so this is the type of question that we are prohibited from asking. And this goes to show that this person is not really busy doing that which is obligatory upon them, and staying away from that which they are prohibited from attaining. They are busy with what if this happened, suppose that happened, and that of course yields no result, except the increase in the questioning and the asking will yield what? Into arguments. فَإِنَّمَا أَهْلَكَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ كَثْرَةُ مَسَائِلِهِمْ وَاخْتِلَافُهُمْ عَلَىٰ أَنْبِيَائِهِمْ. That they would ask their prophets and their messengers so many questions, and one after the other, to the extent that they get to the nitty-gritty details and begin to argue with their own prophets and messengers. And imagine someone is questioning and brought their own, bringing their own prophet and messenger to question and objections and so on and so forth. So this is indeed the perfect recipe to destruction, وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. وَمَا لَهَيْتُمْ مَا أَمَرْتُكُمْ بِهِ مَا لَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْهُ فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ وَمَا أَمَرْتُكُمْ بِهِ فَأْتُوا مِنْهُ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ فَإِنَّمَا أَهْلَكَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ كَثْرَةُ مَسَائِلِهِمْ وَاخْتِلَافُهُمْ عَلَىٰ أَنْبِيَائِهِمْ. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who listen to the words of wisdom and follow the best of it. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to teach us that which benefit us, and to benefit us with that He taught us, and to increase us in knowledge. هذا والله تعالى أعلى وأعلم. سبحانك اللهم بحمدك. نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين جزاكم الله خيرا السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.